Water safety in buildings. My name is Holly and I'm part of the professional development team here at IIRSM. In this webinar, Martin Ronceret, Technical Director at AMVMR Consulting, will provide an introduction into open and closed water systems found at both work and home. Before I hand over to Martin, there are just a couple of housekeeping type things that I need to run through first. So first of all, you'll be on mute for the duration of the webinar. However, if you have any questions, please feel free to type these in the chat function on the bottom right-hand corner of the screen, and we will pick those up at the end of the presentation. And then secondly, this webinar is being recorded, and the recording will be available on IIRSM's YouTube channel later on today. Okay, thank you very much. Martin, over to you.
Thanks, Holly. Hello, everyone. So as Holly said, my name is Martin. I work for AMVMR as a technical director. I also work as a principal consultant for BizRIA, which is a national association for building services in the UK. And I help them to do forensic investigation in buildings and also on water system to better understand and find out issues in water system. Before my time at BizRIA and AMVMR, I was working in marine and subsea industry. We were working on large facility processing plants and like water injection line, which operated at over 200 bar. So 200 bar, to give you an idea, in buildings, you usually have 10 bar pressure in water system, and high rise may go up to 20 bar as part of the design. So this was 10 times more than what we're dealing in buildings. So very high safety requirement and quotient to be taken into account. But today I'm talking about buildings. Let's go to the next slide. So today's presentation, so I'm going to do an overview on water system in buildings, so what you need to be considered for the safety. So first thing, like, is water really safe? A bit on legislation, the boring part. Then we go to more interesting part, like open and closed system. That's the two type of system you will see in buildings. And then when you see issues, and then a brief summary. But first, there's a polling question. So Holly, if you can go to the polling one, just as a start. So which water would you drink with confidence? So you got from a cold tap, hot tap, obviously mixed with cold because you don't want to be scalded. A water fountain maybe, a bottle, obviously a sealed bottle, or any natural source of outdoor, or not at all. So you can select the one, could be more than one. I will see the result. So I think you need to go on your, it should be on your screen.
Right, I'll end the voting.
I don't know, do you see any, let's see what we get.
Okay. So these are our results. From a bottle seems to be most popular.
Can you see it on the screen? So...
Can you see those, Martin?
I don't see. I only see... Thank you for participating in the survey.
Oh, okay. Well, I can tell you now that from a bottle is the most popular option.
Okay.
And followed by from a cold tap, from a hot tap or a natural source, and then from a water fountain. And one person has selected none of the above.
Okay. Thank you, Ali. So your bottle seems to be the most popular one, and then cold water. That's all right. I mean, at least you're drinking water, which is very important because that's one of the best source of fluid to be taken for human. But then water, is it really safe? So I identify some of the hazard that water will be concerned when transporting, storing water to the user. So you could physical hazard, the material. So for instance, if you got lead in your pipework, that could be a contaminant. Rubber, could harvest bacteria, so you may want to select suitable material. And I put an example on a slide where you got the lead solder to join different pipe. And there are still some of these joints in buildings because I do see some of them when we do investigation. For equipment, that's mainly storage tanks, cold storage tank, but you got also the smaller piece of equipment like backflow prevention, and I will go later on that. So if they fail, then you can have an issue on the water, it could contaminate or cross-contaminate. Temperature, essentially scalding. So you got hot water, and you see a lot of these caution very hot water signs in building near taps, showers, and so on. That's for the physical. Then on the chemical side, hopefully you don't expect to have much chemical in the water you will drink. You may still need some disinfectant or chlorine, for instance, in very small dosage to kill any bacteria or microorganism. So you need to be properly dosed as well, otherwise it could be a toxic hazard. Then you got other hazards like microbiological hazard, bacteria, because bacteria are present naturally in water. So from ponds, even in the sea, you got a lot of bacteria and so on in the ground. So bacteria will be there. You will expect bacteria to be there and it just need to be managed. So it's a hazard that need to be managed. I summarize one of the key bacteria we're going to look or that is crucial in building safety is Legionella. And I've got another slide afterwards that go much more in detail of how why is it so important to manage this bacteria. But first I wanted to show you a summary chart of why this bacteria or how is it surviving. So as you see, below 20 degree, the bacteria is still alive, but it's kind of dormant, so it's not really active. And above 50, 60, the bacteria will die. It takes more or less much more time, and at 70 degrees, expected that it will be fully killed. But the most interesting thing is at 37 to 38 degrees, which is about human body temperature, that's the optimal growth rate of this bacteria. So if you get it in your body, it will be happy life for the bacteria because you are at the right temperature for it to harvest. Another item to take into account for safety is the users. So we can look at the water side, and as you see, physical, chemical, and microbiological hazard, which mean you need to understand the physics, like hydraulics of water, but also chemistry. So you almost need to be a chemist as well, and a microbiologist as well to understand how bacteria can survive and live and grow. Regarding users, that's the people who could be affected or harmed by the water. So I put three categories like age, gender, and immunodeficiency. So age, well, if you think about young people, they may not really understand scalding unless they get burned themselves. So it's important to consider who is going to use the water. And you can also experience the same thing with elderly people. Gender, well, male, female, statistically, when we go to look at Legionella in the form of pneumophila, that this bacteria could affect. Male tend to be more susceptible than women, and especially men older than 55 years old. If that's just based on statistical analysis and cases that has been recorded. The immune system, that will affect how people can survive and fight the bacteria. So when the bacteria get into the body, your immune system will kick in. But for people who are going through surgery, like heart surgery, or going through chemotherapy for cancer treatment, their immune system may be lower, so the treatment could be more effective. But on the other side, it protect them less from bacteria and infections. So I talk about Legionella. So Legionella is a bacteria, so you will see on the microscope. But what it leads to is legionellosis, which is a disease. And you got two types, roughly, of disease you can get from Legionella. You can have a fever, so you may have heard of Pontiac fever, which is typically like a flu-type syndromes. But you can have a more serious one, which is resulting in pneumonia, and then we call it a Legionnaire disease. So how is it transmitted? Well, you need to have some very tiny droplets of water. One case of ice has also been recorded, and that needs to be absorbed by human through the lungs, and then this is where inside the lungs the bacteria will develop and create this form of pneumonia. Incubation period, 2 to 14 days from exposure of the bacteria, which means that from the day you've been infected or you absorb the bacteria in your lungs, it may take up to 2 weeks for the disease to appear, which could be very tricky when you try to investigate and track back what people have done for the last 2 weeks, where they have been, if they've been exposed, have been traveling. So how to prevent that? Well, we need to minimize the growth of the bacteria in the system. Fortunately, there's no vaccination, so you cannot just be preventive on the people. Treatment could work in the antibiotics. And you can recover for most of the time. Unfortunately, for the pneumophilia pneumonia type, there are still some severe sequelae when you survive, and some people die, unfortunately. And roughly every year in the UK, you got between 300 and 400 people who die from Legionnaire disease. So that's not a small number. So that is on the water safety side, like what the hazard we need to consider and why. Now this is the legislation. So I summarize how the UK legislation is organized. So on top, you got the acts that are issued by parliament or orders. Then you got regulation that are derived from the act, so they are much more specific. Then you got code of practice, some are approved code of practice, so that's where it should be followed or give you a much more practical code of practice, practical approach of how to implement the regulation. And then you got industry guidance and standards. So most of the acts that are or that would be relevant to water safety in buildings, I've listed them here. So obviously you got the Water Act and Industry Act, because that's where the water comes from, that feed into the building. Health and safety at work, that could be applied to any business activity in the building. So companies, office, retails, all this will be covered by that. It will also cover landlords, so people who are renting the house. That's part of a business activity, so that will also fall part of this act. Housing Act, for housing association, food safety, if you've got retail in the building, and we see they use water. So that's the act. Then the regulation, there are much more because there are more specific aspects of the law, because they cover, for instance, the private supply to a building, the water quality. So water quality, that's where you will find the list the level of contaminants, like bacteria, metals, and so on, that are acceptable in the water supply, water fitting, what kind of material you can use. The management of health and safety at work, that's where I ask or require to do a risk assessment, and I will come later on that. The building regulation, there are several parts. The two key ones related to water are part G and L. The workplace health and safety welfare regulation, that's where you got welfare, so where you need to provide toilets facilities, for instance, so where you're going to use water. The COSH, that's really when you're going to use chemicals or because of the risk of bacteria in the water, this also falls under COSH, especially Legionella. And as you want to manage the bacteria and using, you may use biocide, and then you need to use a biocide product regulation to be compliant. Also, if your building has evaporative condenser or cooling towers, you have under the notification of the regulation to comply. All these documents, they can be found on the legislation.gov.uk and they are downloaded for free. Now the code of practice. So code of practice will be example or much more detailed guidance of how to comply with the law and the regulation. So on Legionella, the Health and Safety Executive, HSE, in the UK, we develop an approved code of practice, which is L8. There's also one on chemicals, L5. And then they develop additional guidance, so SAG 274 in different parts to cover cooling towers, domestic hot and cold water, over water system. The 282 is related to spa and pools, and 17 for landlords. Then when we talk to healthcare, the Department of Health and Social Care have developed separate guidance, the HTM. British Standard as well, they develop a code of practice. So one has been recently updated, which is BS 8580, which is related to risk assessment for Legionella control. And then if you have, you're dealing with pool, swimming pool, you may want to go to the PewTag website and download their code of practice, because it got very informative and practical guidance on how to manage the water in pool and swimming pools. Then you got industry guidance, which are reflecting best practice standard. So you got the British Standard Institute, who publish several documents. So we cover thermal mixing valve, water sampling, design, installation, testing, disinfection and cleaning, and so on, of the water in buildings. The BISRIA guide, they tend to cover more commissioning, cleaning, flushing, maintenance, but also Legionella risk assessment and logbooks for a facility manager. The SIPSI guide are more on public health and plumbing. Again, HSE have their published industry guidance, essentially on Legionella. And then you got over from Institute for Water Treatment, and also the World Health Organization. They have published two guidance on water safety in building and guidelines for drinking water quality. So when you say you're drinking water from a bottle, that's where the WHO will be also considered. So some interesting point that the regulation are defining is different category of water. So we split into five categories. So category one is wholesome water. That's the water you should get from your tap, the cold tap, I should clarify. And that complies directly with the Water Industry Act. Now, from this cold water, if you heat it, so you get hot water, that falls under category two because there's an aesthetic change in the quality of the water. So the taste may have changed, the appearance of the odor. Now, if you start to add chemicals, you may fall under category three, especially if you add glycol or sodium hypochlorite bleach into it. So it could become toxic. And if you add a lot of chemicals or pesticide and other corrosion inhibitors and things like that, that would be a category four. And the fifth category is really for very dangerous water. So you may have radioactive element in it. So as usually when in lab, when they do testing, they may reject some of the water. There will be a category five water, or they store it. There may be blood as well in pathogenic case, like butcheries. They will reject blood, so that will be contaminated. There will be a category five. And also, if there is any fecal or human waste in the water that could be stored and then processed later on, that will be category five as well. Now, when you deal with building, you need to understand who is responsible of what in the water safety. And basically, you got two entities, the water undertaker or the water supplier. So the organization company will be supplying water to the building. And then you got the person, or what we call a duty holder, who is responsible to manage the water quality inside the building. I put a little diagram or schematic of where you got the connection. And that's where it's usually, it could be very tricky to understand where is the boundaries, because the boundary could be just at the connection of the pipe, the main water pipe from a water undertaker, to the connection of a branch that goes into a building, or it could be at the water meter. And because it varies, that needs to be checked. When you are a duty holder, you need to make sure you understand which part or where is the boundaries for responsibility. Because if there's a contamination in the water and you find out in the building that the water coming is not safe or is not of good quality, you want to understand if it comes from the water undertaker or it comes from the building itself. There's something wrong, like pipework or a leak. So that needs to be checked and clarified when you own a building or when you take ownership of a building, to understand where exactly the boundary is. If it's at the property, is that, or is that the water meter, or is that just a connection of an isolation valve? Now, this water undertaker or water supplier, they have duties. Very simple duty. They have to provide safe water to the buildings, commercial and domestic as well. And that's why they get a license. So to check they do their work properly, we got the Drinking Water Inspectorate that do check and inspect and test water for the quality they're supposed to do. So if you go on the DWI website, you got annual reports for all the water suppliers, which are licensed, obviously, in the UK. So I pull out the result from last September, and you see that they do test the water that, so when it leaves the water treatment works, that means it go into a distribution network that will go then to the buildings or to the houses. So we test for the coliform bacteria and E. coli, and the level, which is stated in the regulation, is none. So you shouldn't have any at all in the water. So you can see they do quite a lot of tests, 46,000 something, but they still managed to find some on what they tested. What is also interesting is in this report, so if you know who is your water supplier in your area in the UK, they will tell you where they failed on some of the tests, and they also have to explain why they failed or what they did to also what they did to correct the action. So sometimes when they do upgrade the water treatment plant, they have an outbreak of bacteria or high value of chemicals, and then they need to rebalance afterwards. But that's in the report, and that's really interesting. They also show some pictures of rework they do, so like an excavation and of a pipe work. So we saw what the water supplier has to do. Now the designer of the building and the constructor, they also have to comply in the building regulation. So I talk about materials. Well, they need to make sure that the water used, that the material used for drinking water is of sufficient quality. And this is fall under the WRAS scheme, or water regulation approval scheme. They also have to prevent water when it's stored to exceed 100 degrees, because we're dealing with liquid water. If you go above 100 degrees, you're dealing with steam. So that's a completely different scenario and configuration. They have to provide system for expansion and safe charge, because as you heat water, it will expand. And when you get cold, it will still have a high density. And that's particularly important for closed water system. So basically, you need to install expansion vessel pressurization units to manage the variation in volume of the water cold and hot. And then the preventing backflow. So that's essentially to prevent cross-contamination or contaminated water, used water to go back in the clean water of the mains. There's over 25, 26 different solutions. I only picked up the two most common ones. So the first one is an air gap. You will typically see it on a breaking tank. And that's approved up to category 5. So if you remember when I introduced earlier the different fluid category, that's why you will apply, because it will help you to select which backflow prevention system or solution would be suitable depending on the fluid category you are dealing with. So Cat 5, you can use a air gap like you will see on most of the tanks. If you use a reduced pressure zone valve or RPZ, that's suitable up to category 4. And all these solutions, they need to be inspected every year and tested for the RPZ as well. Because if they fail, then you can have cross-contamination. So it's important that they are maintained properly. Now, looking at the duty holder. So the duty holder, they are responsible for the water quality or safe water inside the building. And the tricky part is, even if the water supplied by the undertaker is not of good quality, the responsibility is still under the duty holder of a building. So we tend to see that during the summer period, which is now, where the water supplier can supply water at temperature above 25 or 25 degrees C, because they cannot really control the water in some of the pipework, distribution pipework. But then the duty holder, they try to keep the water, the cold water, below 20. So if you remember from the chart with Legionella, under 20 degrees, the bacteria is quite kind of dormant, so you want to maintain your cold water cold. But because your incoming water may be above 25, you cannot really do anything about that. So you still need to find a way to manage when you get into a building, how to keep the water cold and safe. So as part of a requirement, the duty holder has to register any cooling tower, evaporative condenser with local authorities. There's a regulation dedicated to that. They also have to appoint a responsible person. And this responsible person, they must have sufficient competency and authority to manage the risk of a water system in the building. So what does that mean? Well, if you look at the management of health and safety at work, they define a competent person as someone who has sufficient training and experience or knowledge and other qualities that allow them to assist you properly. And also the HSC, they highlight that the level of competence required will depend on the complexity of the situation of a system that need to be assessed and managed. When we deal with healthcare, it's difficult to have only one person because it's so complex to manage healthcare premises. So we create what is called a water safety group, which will have several specialists and experts that will manage and will input into the scheme of water safety management. So this responsible person, they have to carry a risk assessment. And from a risk assessment, they need to identify any control measure that need to be put in place and implemented in the building. And this is mandatory to be in a written form if there's more than 5 employees in the company or organization. One thing that the health and safety executive says is to conduct a risk assessment, the person must be competent as well. So technically, your responsible person could also be your risk assessor. And that's particularly valid for simple water system. And there is an example in the approved code of practice L8 on Legionella, where I give you, if you have a small and simple water system in the building, you don't need to take particular control measure or precaution, unless, but it's still important to review risk assessment regularly in case there is any change to the water system, or if there is any reason to suspect that the risk assessment is not valid anymore. So that's why risk assessment tend to be, they may be done once, but it need to be reviewed and they need to be kept up to date, which is the last point, is to keep records. It's very important to keep records because if I go to the next slide, when you get, if you do break the law or you are in breach of material, the HSE can come and visit and they may assess and say, are you compliant? They can issue an enforcement notice, and there will be fee for intervention. So HSE inspector will charge you for the time they spend, also the time they spend to write a letter and an enforcement notice. To give you an idea of the cost they charge, we updated it earlier this year, and they charge £154 an hour as a fee for intervention. So if you come a full day, that's quite a lot of money to spend, but need to be paid, and also you need to pay within 30 days. So it's very important to be compliant. So if you found, or the organization is found to be breaking the law, that's considered to be a criminal offense and prosecution. If you don't have any evidence or be able to defend you and you're found guilty, the organization may be fined. And you can see some cases. So on the HSE website, on the health and safety literature, the IRSM website, they also publish cases of people being fined because they breach the law on health and safety, particularly on Legionella. So organizations get fined, but also they could be sentenced, like prison, to company directors and duty holders. And some people think that they are protected by the insurance, the liability insurance, public indemnity insurance, but it doesn't work when it comes to criminal. However, if it's a civil case, so you're sued by negligence or breach of duty, and you're found liable, so similar, you have no evidence or you cannot prove that you did everything that is reasonable and practicable to prevent a breach or someone to be harmed, you may have to pay damages or compensation. And then hopefully if you have an insurance that covers that, they can pay, but you still need to pay a premium for that. And if you find not guilty or not liable, then that's fine, you can walk, but it's still a hard time to go through all that when you're on breach or you found not being compliant. So to briefly summarize what the building owner should consider is have someone responsible for water safety, and it could be a group of people, like a water safety group, have risk assessment, have records, keeping records is essential, and have a scheme of control to maintain water safe for user, and also check design and modification. Holly, can we go to the polling? I got another polling question. Yeah, thank you. So in a building, which water system do you think would be the most critical? Taps and showers, storage tank, recreational installation, like fountains, decorative, recreational installation is mainly pools and spa. Decorative ornamental is more fountain. All the equipment for cleaning or fire protection, or your central heating and cooling system. So which one do you think will be the most critical and where we should focus the management and where the risk would be higher?
Right, I'm gonna end the voting.
Yeah, same. See, thank you for. Ah, yeah, we see the percentage.
Can you see the results now?
I think we need to scroll down.
Okay.
That's okay.
So yeah, we had taps and showers and storage
Storage
tanks as
down,
well.
suppression. Okay. So nobody thinks like decorative product or central heating are really a concern or that critical. That's fine. If you can go back to the
There
presentation. So let's start with open water systems. So which are they? I need to move on because I see the time and well, typically you'll be well, tap showers, toilets, pool spa, hot tubs, steam room and hammam, maybe, but if it's steam form, you don't really temperature should be high enough when it came out into a room. Cool water storage tanks, hot water cylinder or calorifier as well. But also misting and fogging and humidifiers devices. So you can see one here. That's also important to consider. So that's where most of them you will find inside the building, but you can see there's also some outside the building. The cooling towers and the evaporative condenser, they are usually on the top of a building, on the side of a building, and they're kind of hidden in the fabric. So they don't really appear so obvious unless you know what you're looking for. And they are essentially for providing cool water to chill water system in air conditioning. Mentioned fountain, irrigation system as well. You're spraying your watering the landscape. Some building will have a car wash or water jetting and spraying installation. Talk about water suppression, fire suppression system. So you got fire hose, sprinkler system, wet risers. That's also part that will tend to be in and out of a building. More recently, or we see more and more, water harvesting system. So for instance, they will collect water from the rain and then they will use it to flush the toilets. But they could also be the water dispenser. Your coffee machine, you will feed water into it. And according to the World Health Organization, in the water safety guideline, you should also consider water bottles and overusage. So overusage would be water to clean, like the chap on the wall, cleaning the windows. Water in the tank, an aquarium, that's also be something to consider. So why are these systems so important? Well, they can directly expose the user to water. So if you've got contamination, chemicals, if it's too hot, or it's bacteria. It could be difficult to control, especially if the water is replenished frequently from the mains or from a tank. So the quality, it could be difficult to manage the quality because it's changing all the time. So unless you do and sample and test regularly. And yeah, it may contain harmful substance, biocide, pathogenic organism that need to be managed. Some question I do get asked or inquiries is how do you manage in terms of fire suppression system? So the sprinkler system, the water will come out, and if the water is dirty, what can you do with that? Well, the argument is the firefighting system should prevail on water quality because when the water, the sprinkler or the shower goes in the building, the people should have evacuated already, so they won't get exposed to any dirty water if it was not of good quality. The only thing you need to be careful, and that's in the health and safety document, is when you do test the sprinkler system, the person who does test, the maintenance person, they need to be careful not to be exposed to any droplets because they could be contaminated with bacteria. So basically, well, how you should manage them in the building? Well, now it's time to get your to-do list. You need to understand and find out who is responsible for this system, who is going to assess them and assess the risk to the users, and how much exposure they can get, and who are the users. You need to understand who is going to work in the building, who is going to visit the building, who will monitor them. So is it somebody, is it the same person? Is it another group of persons? Are you subcontracting the testing, the control measures? And who is keeping the records? The record needs to be done. If someone is doing, if you employ a subcontractor to do measurement and they keep the measurement, well, you need to be able to show if there's a health and safety HSE inspection, but you have records in-house or you have access to the record, easy access to the record. So it's easier if you keep them with yourself in, as a duty holder. So what typically we would consider? Well, temperature. So if you remember the chart on the survival chart for Legionella, keep the water cold and the hot water hot. So typically cool water will be below 20 degrees C and hot water above 50, 55, depending if it's healthcare. And if you store it, it should be above 60 degrees. Keep the system clean, especially cooling tower packs, cool water storage tanks, hot water cylinders. Check the filters, garbage, the bags, and also check the water dispenser filters. Stagnant and low flow, little use outlet, maybe the shower installed in the locker room, especially if you your building has been designed with BREEAM credits. They may have considered to have additional credit by installing a locker room for cyclists. But they didn't necessarily think that this locker room or with a shower, could be only used part of the year. So you may be a little use outlet during the winter season. Pressurization unit, they're mainly on the domestic hot water system and boosted cold water system. And if you look at the SFG 274 part 2, they propose a design for with water flowing through it. The downside is it doesn't really control properly the pressure. So you tend to have like a membrane or balloon type to maintain the pressure. And to improve the flow inside the water, you may have to use a special flow through system or valve that force the water to go through and move inside the membrane. Because otherwise there's very little change of water inside the pressure vessel. An unused area of building could be where toilets are never used, or if you have different floor in a building where they're not really occupied all the year. And seasonal utilization could be, as I said, the shower room for the cyclist, or it could be for changing room in for seasonal sport events. Microbiology, so you need to test. So it's required to test for commercial pool, hot tub and spa, cooling towers as well. And it's highly recommended for other commercial water system, especially if there's a suspicion of cross-contamination or simply to validate that your biocide treatment or your disinfection is working. It's recommended that you use lab testing instead of field testing, so testing on site, because it could give you, having a lab tested by a lab would give you a consistent testing method, and also you could have a UCAS accredited testing method, so it's recognized across different labs. Also, one word of caution, be aware that building with storage tank, they can face increased risk of chlorine-resistant bacteria, so therefore it's good to have another means of disinfection, not just relying on biocide or chlorine. So the next one, that's a video, Holly, with an example of how you will check that in-service is working properly.
Bear with me one moment.
On this video.
Okay.
Can you play it again? Because I think it went very fast.
Okay.
So in this real life, thanks, Oli. If you can go back to the slide.
There you go.
In this real life example, you can see that in the toilet cubicle, the hand wash basin and the hand dryer has been squeezed into a limited space. It does happen quite a lot in toilets, cubicle toilets. And you can see on the video that the hand dryer can still operate or be operated while the tap is running, and then there's splashing water droplets outside the basin. You can also arguably consider that because the electrical hand dryer is so close to water tap, you need additional special electrical safety to be considered to avoid electrocution of a user. But there are other cases. So in this shower room, that's the same shower room, you can see that several issues can be highlighted from the design, installation, and maintenance or repair. So you can see on the left-hand side, you got long runs of mixed water pipework. So there's no segregation of cold and hot water. So that's perfect condition to harvest bacteria if it's not used. In the middle, you got a leaking valve. So that could be an ingress of air inside the system. And on the right-hand side, you got two lengths of pipe, which are dead legs. So they are capped pipe ends. So there's no flow of water through them. They have not been removed from a pipe system. So they also, again, it could be a great reservoir of bacteria. So that's done for the open water system. Now I'll move quickly to the closed water system. So usually there are space heating and cooling system in the building. So radiators, fan coil units, cassette, trench heating, radion panels, the heat plate exchanger, the chill beams. You can also consider ground and air source heat pumps and solar heaters as well, become popular now. So where are they also important to consider? Well, they are less predictable failure and the exposure to user is difficult to anticipate. They could be more difficult to monitor because there's an easy access to sample. On open water system, the water is coming out, so it's kind of easier to take a sample of water from a tap, showers, fountain, and so on. The closed system, they are closed, so they're not meant to be open at some point. So unless you got drain cocks or special sampling point, for instance, in plant room, it could be quite difficult to sample. And they cannot contain much more harmful substances, high-level microorganisms, biocide, inhibitor, antifreeze, and oxygen scavenger, and so on. So how should you manage them? Well, pretty similar way as the open system. You need to understand who is responsible for them, who is going to assess the risk, monitor the control measure, and obviously keep the records. You may look more particularly in part L of the building regulation when you go and check how they're operating. Which aspect should you monitor or manage? Pretty similar. So also keeping the temperature is not directly relevant because it's more for heating or cooling the space of a building. But it's important to keep cleanliness, maintain clean water, so it's also improving the efficiency or maintaining energy performance of a system. Keeping water moving, because stagnant and low flow rate area are more likely to promote microbiological growth and corrosion. Especially if the control relies on chemicals like biocide and inhibitor, because they need to be uniformly distributed around the system. So when you got stagnant area, they may not see any chemicals like biocide or inhibitor. Again, if you think about your heating system, it's not really used for months during the summer period, or your cooling system being at rest during the winter season, in which state do you think you're going to find them when you're going to need them the next season? So that needs to be managed in between. Testing, same thing. You want to test to have an idea of if a level of bacteria is or corrosion is acceptable in the system. Using laboratory with UCAS accreditation gives you a reassurance that the test is done consistently. And it's also important to select lab that can test processed water and not necessarily just drinking water, because these labs, because they're aware of how to test processed water, they have a better understanding of how to test for inhibitors, corrosion product, and how, and also they will expect higher rates of bacteria than they could find in drinking water. So during operation, you also need to check they are working properly. So I just take a simple case of a tower rail. So I found two issues on this one. You got early sign of corrosion under the rail near the welds. And there's also a leaking joint, which shows some form of contamination with mixed chemical and possibly microbiological. So the issue with a leaking joint is it could be a point of entry for oxygen, and oxygen in your system, and closed system, that will result in more corrosion to the steel component. Same, a microbiological growth could also result in localized corrosion, and some of the byproducts of bacteria could be ammonia, and ammonia is quite detrimental because it promotes stress corrosion cracking in brass component and joints, so it can lead to a valve cracking. So when you start having issues, what should you do? So if you find that you got your cold water is not that cold, or your hot water is coldish, should you shut it down? Or if the system is found dirty or contaminated, and it's usually easy to observe on open water system, you can see that the water is not that clean or transparent. But what about closed water system, where you cannot really see the color of the water? Also, when you inspect and find leaks or sign of corrosion, or if you do test the water and your lab come back with some positive or high count of bacteria, what should you do? Well, my advice would be investigate. Hiding your head, in the sand won't help solving the issue or resolving the fault in your water system. So stop procrastinating. Just do it. You may want to consider the golden hour consideration. This is taken from police investigation, from crime scene. They say within the first hour, this is where you can get the most of the evidence and the information. Also, it could be difficult to capture information within 1 hour. The idea is don't wait weeks to start investigating, collect data and feedback straight away. Almost did it like an accident investigation. Your health and safety officer or manager, because an accident, they investigate straight away. Do the same with your water system. And then follow your backup plan on how to control and operate the system. But that means you need to have thought about the strategy and have a backup plan in advance. So you could be smart and anticipate. So to anticipate the condition of water system in the building, you will need to understand first how they function and how they could malfunction, so you can identify the critical components and the location to monitor. So if your building is doing some business-focused maintenance in place for the management of the water system, then you should have already identified which are the critical components. It's also important to communicate. If you look on the slide, you need to be cautious because there's hot water that can come out of a soap dispenser in the toilet. Putting a sticker where it's not relevant just lose a point in the communication. But it's also important to collect feedback. You cannot be everywhere looking at all the building services, but get a mechanism in place for the user to report issues they spot or they found, so then it can be investigated and sorted rapidly. Well, let's summarize. I'm getting the time now. Well, water in building, they must be managed all year long, like nature will do with a river flowing through the mountains. A strategy must be in place to manage the risk of poor water quality, so you don't harm users and you don't break the law. Monitor particularly the temperature, cleanliness, stagnant, and low flow rates. and the microbiological level, because it's difficult to control something that you cannot see or feel. And finally, have a backup plan, so you know when to do what to do when you got issues. And for people who know a bit about Legionella, you may have recognized the Bellevue Stratford Hotel in Philadelphia. That's where, in 1976, there was the American Legion 200th anniversary. And in this building, they had an outbreak of Legionella pneumophila in the cooling system, which resulted in 221 cases confirmed of Legionella disease. 34 people died, and that's actually where they decided to name this disease or this outbreak as Legionella disease, taking the name from American Legion. Because I've presented so many things and information, I thought having a kind of infographic summary could be useful, where you can see you start on the top left, where you appoint someone, you get the risk assessment record, then you got the key control measure, there may be more, they may be prioritized depending on your risk assessment. Then if you have an issue at the bottom, when it gets red, what you should do, and then as part of an ongoing process, anticipating, communicating with your user. This infographic, you can download it on the amvmr.co.uk website. You can download it for free in PDF, and you can use it as a aide mémoire in your office, your plant room, maybe the maintenance cabinet or management or board meeting room to remind everyone that water safety is important. Or simply, you can just hide it in your building health and safety file. Thank you, everyone. It's been almost an hour now. Thank you for listening. If you have any question, feel free to ask now or drop me an email. My email is on the slide, martin@mvmr.co.uk. And yeah, let's see if there's any question or...
Thank you for that, Martin. It's very informative. I see we've got someone here requesting the presentation material. So, yeah, I'll send the link out after the event. I'll do that later on this afternoon so everyone can go back and recap on the information in their own time. So, yeah, as Martin said, we've got a couple of minutes. If there is anybody that has any questions, then please do type those in the chat function and we'll answer those. Or if not, you can get in contact with Martin directly at his email. Whilst we're waiting just to see if any questions come through, is the Legionnaire's disease reportable under RIDDOR?
Yes, it is. So RIDDOR is the regulation for reporting injuries, disease, and dangerous occurrences. And that requires all employers or whoever has control of the premises, so the duty holder, to report to the HSE accident and some disease that arise or are connected to a work activity. And actually, this is also stated, so that's a general requirement from RIDDOR, where you need to report any instance. And that's also supported in the approved code of practice L8, where they say it needs to be a legionellosis. So the disease caused by Legionella, so Legionella disease, pneumophila, you need to report under RIDDOR. And there are some conditions, so I need to get, let me open it. So yeah, in the ACOP L8, they say you need to have a doctor notifying the employer. So basically, the person who is sick need to go and so you see a doctor or go to the hospital, and they need to be reported back to the employer. The person need to be an employee. And also, they need to identify the possible exposure. So, like with a cooling tower or the person had been exposed to water system in the building, where it could be a likely source of contamination, then that's reportable. What they don't want is, or you won't be under radar for the employer. If, for instance, the employee come back from holiday, they may have caught Legionella, but at the place where they were on holiday. So that's why they put all these tests. Also, if a person come back from holiday and Legionella disease, it won't be necessarily a radar because it was on holiday, but it will still be counted in the HSE report. So every year, actually every month, the HSE is publishing a report on the status of Legionella disease in the UK, like how many cases. And so because this person will be flagged as having Legionella disease by the hospital or the clinic where they've been
diagnosed,
then it will be counted in the annual report. Because the idea is to monitor how the UK is doing in terms of Legionella disease management.
Okay. All right, we had a few thank yous come through, but I don't think we've got any questions for now.
Question when they actually go in their building and see, oh, didn't see that, or what should I do?
So, yeah, that's
right. Yeah, it's a second stage when, the same when I do lecture, like I was saying, I do lecture like on closed system for a day. Mm-hmm. There's a few questions on the day, but I do get more questions later on because when actually people try to implement or go through and say, oh, do we have all these documents or all this information? Are we missing that? What should we do? And so on.
That's right. And your email address is there. So if anyone does have any questions for Martin later on, please feel free to get in touch. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Martin.
Cheers, Ollie.
Bye. Ollie.